Thank you.
Our new guards are awake. All right, we'll try it again. Good morning.
Good morning.
Awesome. It is great to be with you all this morning. Great to be with those of you joining us on Facebook Live. Welcome to you as well. A few announcements as we get started this morning and get going. First of all, we do have Sunday school meeting at 9:45 in the back corner classroom. And so we have one more week in our current series that's entitled Jesus' Farewell Message. But each one is a standalone, so don't feel like I've missed it, so I'm not going to come. Come join us, 9:45 back there for Sunday school. Men, we are taking a break from men's group this coming Friday. And so we will not be meeting this Friday, and then we'll be resuming our meeting the following Friday, which would be September 9th. We have that happening. There is prayer meeting this Wednesday, which is August 31st at 1:30 in my office. And so if you're available, please come and join us for prayer at that time. Also, you can look in your bulletin and mark your calendar because it's coming up quick. We have on September 10th, which is Saturday, Labor of Love. Meet at 9 o'clock over at Pioneer Park, and then again at noon for lunch after the different groups go to their different ministry sites. And then on Saturday, September 17th, is WOW, Women of Worship. And more information and sign-ups for you ladies will be coming out soon for that. And then September 24th, also on Saturday, is our Highway Cleanup. And we meet here at 8 o'clock, and we go clean up our section of the highway, and it's a great time, great opportunity to serve our planet, serve our Lord, serve our community, and so want to invite you to join us for that. And so again, just our offering plates are in the back before our offering plates is in the back before we leave. And then last announcement before we lead into worship music is, again, something I am very excited about. And so I'm going to ask Christiana to step forward and to share about our, what's it called now?
Circle
Suppers. Sam, okay. Circle Suppers.
I love that he said, I am very excited about it, because last week when we talked, he also said he was excited about it. Because I told him, you have to be excited, otherwise people won't come.
I know. Okay.
So he's very excited. So Circle Suppers, if you signed up last week, we have your information. They are dinners that we have five now, host family. So do not feel obligated to be a host in any way. We want to have dinner with you. And so the goal is the host will call you on the phone if you sign up and set up a date for the month of September to have dinner together. Anywhere from like 6 to 8 folks getting together to eat dinner. And then the idea is that over the course of the year, we as a church body will have had an opportunity to mix with different folks and get to know one another. So I have the sheet from last week, so don't feel like you have to sign up twice. And let's see, is there anything else that I forgot to say? Oh, the host is responsible for providing the main dish, and then the people who attend the meal bring sides. And the host can decide whatever they would like to about that. So is there anything else?
The other thing is, this is not going to be just a one-time thing.
Yeah.
We are going to continue doing this and rotating through, so that there will be an opportunity to fellowship with everyone, hopefully, in the congregation during the time. So, you know, if you're like, oh, I was really hoping to have supper at the Nielsen's, and you're not placed with
I'll
us
cook.
That
you won't
one
cook.
Time.
No.
Because you don't
it
want
be like
me to.
Microwave for Papa Murphy's, right?
That's right.
Yeah. Okay. Peanut butter and jelly circle supper. You know,
that's
so.
Right.
Our kids want
you to. All right.
Good thing, right? All right.
We're on it.
All right.
And then we're taking November, December off. So it's September through May, and we'll take off November, December, right? Yeah?
Yes.
Okay. So I'll send this to your guys this way.
All right. And with that, if you would all stand, we will join in worship singing together.
Good morning. We're going to start our worship with prayer.
Thank you.
tomorrow we will have our children's sermon.
Good morning. Last week we encouraged our congregation to pray for all of our students. So students, how was your first, those of you who went, because I got three people here that, four, that have not gone yet. Those of you who went to school, how did it go? Was it good? Silence. So, congregation, what do we need to keep doing?
Praying.
Oh, a thumbs up. Quiet, two thumbs up. How's that? Back to, three thumbs up.
How about you? Thumbs up?
Okay. Okay. So we have some more kids that are going to school for the first time tomorrow, so let's keep them prayed up. We also have an adult that's going to school tomorrow, right? Yeah. Some of our students will even be in my class, right? So that's a lot of Mrs. Nielsen time. Okay. Our scripture today is, I wrote it down and I marked my place, Matthew 23:27. So Matthew 23:27, Jesus said, "Woe to you, teachers of the law and Pharisees, you hypocrites! You're like whitewashed tombs, which look beautiful on the outside, but on the inside are full of the bones of the dead and everything unclean." Ooh. So this is a flower. This is the Titan Arum flower. Some of you might know already about this flower. It can be grow up to 50. So I brought this yardstick. So it can grow 3 yards wide, up to 3 of these, right? Yards wide. And then 15, is that correct? I'm real tired, guys. I was out of school a long time. Okay, the stalk can be 15 feet, and then the bloom can be about 3 feet across. It is irresistible to insects because although it is beautiful on the outside, its nickname is the corpse flower. So it is very attractive to insects because it stinks so badly. It's also endangered in the world. I don't think we need to ask why, right? And it is the hypocrite of the flower world, right? Like it looks so beautiful, but then it smells pretty stinky. And so sometimes our behavior is a little bit like that, right? When we're in certain places and spaces, we are present ourselves as beautiful, but on the inside, maybe it's a bit stinky. So my encourage to you is today is that you be a whole person. Be the same person that you are all the time. Whether you're in front of your mom or dad, or you're at school or you're at home, be the same person. And some of us, all of us are all working on who Jesus wants us to be, right, all the time. So being a whole person in every space and place will help you to grow and be like that, right? Pretending is an awful lot of work. It makes you very tired. So let's pray. Dear God, we praise you and thank you that you love us, whether we're stinky or not, whether our behavior is so beautiful or is not so great. And we don't want our lives to be stinky or foamy, but we want our lives to glorify and honor you. And so we ask you to help us to do the right thing, do your right thing, no matter where we are or who is watching us. In your name we pray. Amen.
At this point in time, we have the opportunity to go before God in prayer as a congregation. And I want to invite you and encourage you during this time that if you feel comfortable doing so, to pray a prayer out loud. And if you don't feel comfortable doing that, no problem. I want to encourage you to pray silently with us. And if you're here this morning and you're just feeling like, I'm not sure how to pray, or I just don't know what to pray, again, no problem, because Scripture says that the Spirit will pray on your behalf. And so we have the privilege, the honor of going before God, our Father, directly. And so we get to do that together. So let's pray now. Oh, dear Lord, we do thank you and praise you for this morning, for your many blessings. And again, the blessing of just being together. We're gathering together to worship you through song, through fellowship, through prayer, through hearing your word. And Lord, hearing from you. And so, Lord, we just thank you for this time, this honor, this privilege to come to worship you. Lord, we are again just so blessed that because of your Son and what your Son did on the cross, that we are able to come directly to you with our prayers. Our prayers of praise and our prayers of request. And Lord, again, you are faithful to answer. And sometimes that answer is yes. Sometimes that answer is no. And sometimes that answer is wait. And so, Lord, we do pray that we would be attuned to your rhythm and your answer, and not try and manipulate you to our will. Lord, we thank you this morning for just some answered prayer, although we continue with more prayer for Alex Saez. It's great to have Alex and Stacy with us this morning. And Lord, we just pray for Alex as he goes another appointment tomorrow to find out the treatment plan. Just pray for him and Stacy. Lord, we do pray for the students that started school last week, for their continued encouragement at school. Lord, we pray for the students that are going to be starting school tomorrow. Lord, and for the teachers that started last week, and as well as the teachers that start tomorrow. And we lift them to you right now in all of these changes. Lord, and as we lift the parents to you as well, because it is a time of changing schedules and changing routines and just so much change. And so that can be challenging for everyone. And so we lift that to you. Lord, we just praise you for all who are here this morning. And Lord, again, we praise you for the honor, the privilege of coming to you and lifting our prayers to you. So hear us now as we pray as a congregation.
Lord, I ask that you be with Sid this morning, that he's on the other end of the weather, but Lord, that you will heal him quickly and he can be back fellowshipping with us. Lord, I ask you for my family and my friends. You know what's going on there, and just glad we have a call.
Father, I lift up our family, Lord, you know we are going to be sorrow as we pass to the body on what we want to do and how we want to do it in sorrow. Lord, help you and the fellow for that listen to your word. I
Lord, again, we give you praise. Praise, well, many blessings. Praise this opportunity to be together. Lord, we give you praise that we can come before you with our prayers. Praise that you know us. You know our prayers even before we speak them, or even if we don't speak them. You still hear our prayers and are faithful to each other. We give you praise that even when we are not sure how to pray or what to pray, that your Spirit prays on our behalf. Mm-hmm. And Lord, we do pray also right now that you would open our ears and our hearts and our minds to hear from you what it is you want to teach us today. And Lord, in all that we do, all that we are, both individually as well as the congregation, may you, Lord, be glorified. And it's in the mighty name of Jesus Christ we pray all these things. Amen. We will dismiss our children to children's church at this point in time. And as they head out, we will have our scripture reading and prayer.
For our scripture reading this morning, it's from Jeremiah 9, 23 and 24. This is what the Lord says. Let not the wise man boast of his wisdom, or the strong man boast of his strength, or the rich man boast of his riches. But let him who boasts boast about this, that he understands and knows me, that I am the Lord who exercises kindness, justice, and righteousness on earth. For in these I delight, declares the Lord. Let's have our scripture together. The heavens proclaim the glory of God. The skies display his craftsmanship. Day after day, they continue to speak. Night after night, they make him known. They speak without sound or word. Their voice is never heard. Yet their message has gone throughout the earth, and their words to all the world. May the words of my mouth and the meditation of my heart be pleasing to you, O Lord, my rock and my redeemer. Amen.
Let's stand together as we worship.
Yeah.
We are continuing our study in Luke, and I want to invite you right now to open your Bible to our passage for today, Luke chapter 9, verses 23 through 27, and we're going to read that together in just a moment. Today's sermon title is titled Consecration in Action. And so join me reading together Luke chapter 9, verses 23 through 27. Then he, talking about Jesus, said to them all, "If anyone will come after me, he must deny himself and take up his cross daily and follow me. For whoever wants to save his life will lose it, but whoever loses his life for me will save it. What good is it for a man to gain the whole world and yet lose or forfeit his very self? If anyone is ashamed of me and my words, the Son of Man will be ashamed of him when he comes in his glory and in the glory of the Father and of the holy angels. I tell you the truth, some who are standing here will not taste death before they see the kingdom of God." Well, I want you to imagine your life in terms of a corporate boardroom in a high-rise Fortune 500 office building. And imagine that there's a long mahogany table surrounded with leather chairs. An executive committee is seated around that table, and each member represents a different aspect of your life. So seated there is your private self, your work self, your moral self, your recreational self, your financial self, your home self, as well as others. And most of the time, there is conflict in that boardroom as decisions are made. Not every department agrees with each other. There's often tension in that room as the committee members argue and debate and question and finally vote. And typically, it is not a unanimous vote. Well, the average perspective in the church at large today is that following Jesus means that you invite him to serve on this committee. And you maybe even see it as, well, we have a seat at the head of the table for Jesus reserved. You make him chairman, and you even give him a vote. But then he just becomes one more challenge, one more complication maybe, one more voice in the debate of how you should run your life. Well, the biblical viewpoint for a disciple of Christ is that Jesus comes in and fires the entire committee. Every member. It means saying to the Lord, there is only one vote now, and it's all yours. You run every department of my life. Well, in chapter 9 of Luke's gospel account, the Lord has just informed his disciples of some news that does not exactly fit with the direction of this particular committee. They were looking forward to a kingdom with personal crowns and thrones. But Jesus just told them in verse 22 that he would be rejected and killed and then resurrected 3 days later. Matthew's account tells us that Peter, whom we might call the committee chairman, stepped forward and effectively told the Lord that he was not going to vote for that. And the other disciples were not going to vote for it either. And the Lord rebuked Peter and reminded the disciples that his mission was not up for a vote. The Lord delivers even more surprising news to them. And without any apparent transition, we're told here, again, look at verses 23 through 26. Then Jesus said to them all, if anyone will come after me, he must deny himself and take up his cross daily and follow me. Whoever wants to save his life will lose it, but whoever loses his life for me will save it. What good is it for a man to gain the whole world and yet lose or forfeit his very self? If anyone is ashamed of me and my words, the Son of Man will be ashamed of him when he comes in his glory and in the glory of the Father and of the holy angels. Now, before I expound on this text, I actually want to clear up some misunderstandings. Because I've read numerous commentaries on this passage, but there are some commentaries that I read on this passage, and it surprised me to read these authors who believe in justification by faith alone, but effectively turn this passage into justification by faith. Are not going to be represented by a crown, but represented by a cross. Secondly, Jesus is not saying in verse 23, if anyone wants to get saved, let him deny himself. To interpret it that way actually turns the free gift of God into something you have to earn. And thirdly, Jesus tells them, to do something, to take up your cross daily. Now, a works-based interpretation would mean that if on any because there is so much out there as I was studying and reading this that just twists Jesus' words and twists the gospel message. Because throughout the gospel message, it's made clear that it is salvation by faith alone, not of works, lest anyone should boast. So this is not a lesson here on how to become a believer, or even how to prove you're a believer, but how to live like a believer. Warren Wiersbe put it well when he wrote on this text that Jesus is not talking about sonship, he's talking about discipleship. Do you want to live a consecrated life that imitates the Savior? Well, sorts of legalistic and mystic exercises in order to earn the grace of God. In fact, in the late 4th century, Simeon Stylites, an elder, lived in the town of Antioch. Now, he became famous for his denial of personal comforts. He literally lived in a small enclosure built on top of a raised column for 37 years. And it was said that he had reached a state of spiritual perfection or purity. His food even had to be hoisted up to him. He would be venerated by church leaders when he should have been counseled to come down from there and get on with life. Instead, he was sainted because he had denied himself the comforts of life. Well, also in the 4th century, not to pride yourself, but to deny yourself. Put yourself last. Release not good desires or good things, but release self-centered desires and a self-centered life. The height of self-centeredness says, I'm going to go live by myself and never let anybody in. I'm going to go buy a cottage and leave this rat race behind me. I'm going to go someplace where no one will ever bother me again. In fact, I might go sit on a pillow, undisturbed by people. Jesus is not telling his disciples or us here to escape their world. He's telling them to enter their world with an attitude of selfless humility. That's exactly what Jesus himself did. And the battle to act like Jesus is a battle of our heart and our flesh. It's a daily battle in that boardroom. And it starts very young. I was sent the following story by email a couple years ago that came back to me as I was thinking about this and writing it. A mother was preparing pancakes for her sons, Kevin, who was 5 years old, and Ryan, who was 3. And they began arguing over true, because even here, it's not going to be long before the disciples are arguing over who is the greatest, who gets the first pancake, so to speak, who sits on the best throne in the kingdom. So Jesus not only calls his disciples to understand that consecration in action as we imitate Christ will involve an attitude of humility, but secondly, it will involve a daily priority. A daily priority. Notice the next part of verse 23. Jesus says, he must deny himself and take up his cross daily. Again, I want to straighten out a wrong interpretation here. If there's something you must do daily in order to be saved, or even to prove that you are saved, then we're all in trouble. Every single one of us. If we're honest, not a single one of us lives every single day like we should as Christ's disciples. But that does not mean that the goal changes. That does not mean that we dumb down consecration. We're not given excuses here. No, this should be our desire and our direction in life. And I want to point out here that Jesus does not say, take up it also means saying to the Lord, there's only one vote, and it's all yours. It's a priority because each one of us will face new challenges to our agenda every single day. New situations, new people, new problems, and perhaps even new forms of persecution. Now, taking up a cross in the first century was the most dramatic way someone could announce that their life was not their own. Jesus knew all about crucifixion from his culture. When he was around 11 years of age, Judas the Galilean led a Jewish revolt against Rome, and he raided the armory of Sepphoris, where he and his army set up headquarters. This was only 4 miles from Nazareth, where Jesus grew up. And the Roman Empire struck back with a vengeance, burning Sepphoris to the ground. And Jesus certainly would have seen the smoke from that burning town. The Romans stole all the citizens of that town into slavery. They capture 2,000 rebels and every single one of them. Their crosses were lined along the roadside in public view. It was well known what that was all about. To see someone on a cross meant that they were no longer in charge of their own destiny. It meant that their life. The direction. If we're truly following Christ, we're not saying, okay, Jesus, come this way. We're saying, okay, Jesus, I will follow you. Oh, you're turning this way? Okay. I'm turning this way. I'm following you. If he moves one way or the other, you're right behind him, adjusting and responding. And if the Lord is in front, that means we travel at his speed. We turn because he turned. Disciples need to live this way. And in the original Greek, the next three verses, 24, 25, and 26, all begin with the word for. Not F-O-U-R, but F-O-R, for. And that's the little Greek participle used to explain the purpose of what was just said. We could actually translate it because, or this is why. So Jesus gives us three reasons why we should live as consecrated disciples. I want to quickly go through those three. And I want to share these reasons as principles. So number one, first, because it will keep you from becoming absorbed in your own life. Notice verse 24. For whoever wants to save his life will lose it. But whoever loses his life for me will save it. Now, people see the word save here and immediately run to the subject of salvation. But again, Jesus is not talking about saving your life in this verse. The Greek term for soul, which other translations use instead of life here, is psyche, the common word for self. It represents the entirety of one's life. In other words, if you are saving your life just for yourself, if you're keeping yourself all to yourself, you're going to lose out on any kind of life worth living. Jesus is not talking about missing out on life in heaven. He's actually talking about missing out on life here on earth. Can a believer become selfish? A true believer become selfish and waste his or her life? Well, absolutely. Otherwise, Jesus would never have warned us to avoid becoming self-absorbed. James would never have warned us in James 3:16 that wherever selfish ambition exists, there will be disorder, a messed up life. The Apostle Paul wouldn't have warned the believers in Philippi to do nothing from selfish ambition. In other words, don't make life all about your life. Jesus says here, whoever loses his life for my sake will save it. Whoever loses his life. One author paraphrased this well when he wrote, whoever loses sight of oneself. And another author I read paraphrased it in a way that I like even better. He said, whoever lets loose of his life finds it. I like that. Let loose of your life for the sake of Christ. And this will keep you from becoming absorbed in yourself. Well, secondly, because it will keep you from being engrossed by the stuff of earth. Jesus says in verse 25, what good is it for a man to gain the whole world and yet lose or forfeit his very self? In other words, Jesus is saying, follow me and you will not waste your life pursuing things that won't last. Last week, we talked about the most important question that someone answers in this life. And that question is, to you, who is Jesus? Well, the answer to this question also determines a person's eternal future. So you might say that the second most important question someone answers in this life is heaven or hell. And that's all determined based on the answer to the first question, to you, who is Jesus? And then once that question is settled, the believer must daily answer the third most important question, heaven or earth? In other words, if Jesus is your Lord and Savior, you are now going to heaven. That is guaranteed already. And if you are now going to heaven, then don't start living for earth. Now, I want to clarify something real quick here. I'm not saying we don't take care of God's creation. I'm not saying when I say here that don't start living for earth, that we don't care for the planet, that we don't care for the earth. That's not what I'm talking about. But are we living for Christ? And are we living for what is to come? Or are we living for the here and the now and what is around us? That's what I'm talking about. And we answer that question every single day. Well, will not taste death before before they see the kingdom of God. Now, I believe in my referring primarily to that significant event where he takes Peter, James, and John up to the mountain. That is where he reveals his post-ascension glory, the glory of the King in his coming kingdom. And this transfiguration happens to be the very next event recorded by Luke here in chapter 9. Matthew writes about it in chapter 17, verses 2 and 3. And Matthew says, "And he was transfigured before them, and his face shone like the sun, and his clothes became white as light. And behold, there appeared to them Moses and Elijah talking with him." This, I think, is one of the most interesting and with an attitude of humility, with a daily priority, and with a surrendering, thought he was wasting his time. And even many Christians did not like his non-traditional approach to ministry. Still, he persevered and won countless son that he had knelt in the schoolroom at church one day and gave to God all there was of William Booth. Well, years later, his daughter Eva said, that wasn't really his secret. His secret was that he gave himself the benediction for today, which comes from 1 Corinthians 15, verse 58. Therefore, my beloved brothers and sisters, be steadfast, immovable, always abounding in the work of the Lord, knowing that